Some of you still cannot believe. Some people will still not believe. No, it's juice. Let me take you further back. You remember Moses? Moses was born as what? Father was Levi, mother was Levi. I mean, pakka lineage. Yet if you read Exodus chapter 3 verse 10, he became the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Moses was the son of Pharaoh. Who? The devil's daughter. You're the devil's grandson. Hello? You want to check who your father is? Go and check the register. He'll say, Pharaoh's grandson. So Moses is also with the Egyptians, torturing the Hebrews, making fun of them, spitting at them. You know what naughty Egyptian children do, right? I've been there, I lived there, I know. Right? Throwing stones at the slaves, making them do this, making them do that, abusing them, making fun of them. When he was small. But when he came of age, he realized. Somehow the Lord revealed it to him. Maybe his mother told him something. Now, the stone throwing part may not be right. I'm just, using it. So please don't, that's not scriptural, but I'm just adding it to kind of give you the flavor of the story. At some point, he realized who he is. So he leaves the palace. You know the background. So, he leaves the palace and he goes into the wilderness. Moses, at the age of 40, goes into the wilderness. And there he's minding his own business, looking after the sheep, minding his own business. He is a good man. If anybody asks for some milk, he gives. If anybody asks for some mutton for dinner, he gives. Good man. He's a good neighbor. You want to, can you look after my sheep also? I have to go to office today. Moses will. Look, he's as good a man as any man, at this point in his life. Good man. Good man who said, I will no longer do the works of Pharaoh. I will not be a bad boy. I will not commit adultery. I will not sin anymore. I will stop drinking. I will stop gambling. I will stop doing this. I will stop doing that. And he is in the wilderness of goodness. Where is he in? The wilderness of goodness. Human goodness. Because we know a lot of good people around us. They're all in the wilderness of human goodness. But has Moses encountered God? Till this day, he has left Pharaoh. But has he encountered God? Do you know why God waited till 80 to have an encounter with Moses? There are many reasons. I've shared some reasons before. But I want to give you a new reason. Because God's wisdom is manifold. We cannot understand all his wisdom. With one thing he does, he accomplishes many purposes. One reason why God touched Moses at the age of 80 is because he wants to tell some 70, 80, 90-year-old people that you have still not encountered me. It's never too late. Hallelujah. Many people think that because they are attending this church in between the devil and the Mount Sinai, somewhere in between their church is located. There is a church in a place like that, Somewhere between Pharaoh's palace and Mount Sinai, where God's presence is. There is many churches over there. There are many churches. If you have any doubt, go and read Revelation chapter 3. You will find. Don't tell me Revelation is very hard to understand. Even if it's hard to understand, just read it, because there is a blessing for all who read it and who hear it. Revelation chapter 1 and 3. Just simply read it. There's a blessing on you. Hallelujah. This is why Jesus said you must be born again by water and spirit. What is the water we saw? And please take down these verses because I don't have time to read it. I've read it, you know, a few times in the last three talks, but I will give you the references once again. What water means? Water means the word of God. You have to be born again by the word of God. Ephesians 5:26, 1 Peter 1:23, James 1:18, John 15:3, Ephesians 1:13. I'll read that again. Ephesians 5:26, 1 Peter 1:23, James 1:18, John 15:3, Ephesians 1:13. This will tell you why this water is the word of God. Why you have to be born again by the word. Without hearing the word, no one can be born again. You have to be born again by the word and the spirit. Whenever we saw this, right, from creation, whenever the spirit is hovering and the word comes, creation happens. The spirit is hovering over all the people who are hearing this message. It's hovering over the whole earth because he sees that in the hearts of lots of people, the hearts are formless, it's void, and it is dark. And the spirit is hovering. And I pray as this word goes out, word will meet spirit and new creation will happen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. How can you be born again? By hearing the gospel of Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. When you see God's standard, you realize where you are. When you see God's standard, you realize what your standard is. Till then, you think your standard is up there. But when you see God's standard, you realize who you are. It means, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Do you know what it means? To come short of the glory of God? Forever you will be never in the kingdom. Come fallen short of the glory of God for all eternity. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What does it mean? You have no hope to be where God is. You have fallen short. Maybe you think you are near, not far, but you are not in. The wages of sin is death. What is the meaning of all this? There's no hope of life. You are dead. You're already dead. It means being sorry for your sins, repenting of your sins, and turning to Jesus. Believing that Jesus died for your sins, that he took upon himself your sins and gave his righteousness to you. That is what we have to understand this. Please, I'm going to repeat this. You know, I hope I repeat this verse as long as I preach. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. For God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we, who are sinners, might become the righteousness of God. Exchange at the cross. God takes our sins and gives us his righteousness. Hallelujah. I don't know what you see, but I am very righteous. I see a lot of righteous people. I don't know what you think about yourself, but you are all righteous according to the word of God. You carry the righteousness of God if you have put your trust in him. It means that you believe that he died for your sins and God raised him up and has seated him at the right hand of the Father. It means that you die to your self-rule. You die to the devil's rule and you say, Lord, your rule. Not my will, but your will. That actual transaction will happen when you bend your knees before the Lord and you pray, Lord, I am a sinner. I confess my sins before you. I repent of my sins before you. I acknowledge what you have done on the cross for me, that you died for my sins. I accept your righteousness. And I believe that you've taken my sins on yourself. I reject sin, Satan, and the world. And I receive your Holy Spirit. I welcome into my heart as Lord and Savior, and I by your grace want to live a life by your word. That transaction happens there. That's when his righteousness becomes yours and your sins go to him. See, the problem is many Christians have never done this from the heart. Everyone says they believe in Jesus. Which Christian doesn't believe in Jesus? There is believing and then there is believing. I said there is believing and then there is a believing. James 1:18 says, you believe there is one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. So it's, for some people, their faith is just like the faith of demons. The demons believe, they also believe that Jesus is, there is one God. But then there is a believing. And that believing is what we just discussed, when you give your heart to the Lord. Not lips, you give your heart to the Lord. Hallelujah. I want to say this once again. Many people say, I am a Christian, therefore I believe in Jesus. I am a Christian, therefore I believe in Jesus. A million times no. A million times wrong. If you believe in Jesus, you are a Christian. Big difference. Don't say, I'm a Christian, therefore, you know, I believe in Jesus. No. If you are a believer in Jesus, then you are a Christian. And there's a big difference. Half, I don't know what percentage of Christianity is confused. What happens to you, your eternity, depends on what you choose to do with the Lord. I want to quickly take you to one scene. This is something which the Lord showed me recently, and I want to share it with you. You know the scene. Adam and Eve are there in the garden. Satan comes, tempts them, and they both fall. Now they discover they are naked and they want to hide. They hide behind the bush. They clothe themselves with all, you know, we know all that. Till that point, they were clothed with the glory of God. I mean, so much glory, so much light, you cannot see the nakedness. See the glory that God had planned for man. That glory is restored in Christ Jesus. But that's a different topic. We have to understand some of these things, you know, that the glory is restored in Christ Jesus. It's a huge topic. But Adam and Eve, the glory departed them when they sinned, because they died spiritually, and suddenly they discovered no glory, naked, and they are hiding. So God calls Adam, where are you? Didn't God know? Of course God knew. But God wants Adam to know where he is. Simple. And then what happened? Adam blames the woman blames the serpent. God curses the serpent. He punishes the woman. He punishes Adam. We know that story. For dust you are, and to dust you shall return. And then we read these two verses. And Adam called his wife Eve, because she was the mother of all living. Also for Adam and his wife, the Lord made tunics of skin and clothed them. Genesis chapter 3, verse 20 and 21. Have you ever wondered, why did God choose that particular moment to clothe Adam and Eve with skins of tunic? Because God discovered they were naked, or rather they discovered they were naked sometime back, right? The moment they sinned, they discovered they're naked. The moment God called them, where are you? They already knew they were naked. When God saw their nakedness, why didn't God clothe them with tunics of skin? Why did he wait till this particular moment to clothe them with? Why is he letting them walk around naked? My simple question. Why is God allowing Adam and Eve to walk around naked, and, you know, serpent is also there, you know, in front of outs, you know, it's not good. We are not hidden before God, but why display yourself before Satan? Why didn't God cover them before that encounter with Satan? Have you wondered? Why is God letting them walk around naked? I believe it is one of the reasons is this. Because it's quite funny. God is there, the serpent is there, Eve is there, Adam is there. And verse 21, God has just finished pronouncing the curses on Satan, the punishments on Adam, on the woman and on Adam. And out of the blue, Adam does something really funny. Adam turns to his wife and calls her Eve. One word. He calls her Eve. Let me ask you, how long have Adam and Eve been married? I bet they have been married for some time because he's house trained already. Because whatever she says, he listens. It took Abraham, Sarah, some 85 years for her to tell Abraham what to do. So Adam and Eve must have been married for some time. It took Jacob and Rachel a few years of marriage before Rachel could tell Jacob what to do. So I'm presuming by that logic, Adam and Eve must have been married for some time because he's listening to what... So the women are looking very... okay. It's all biblical. I'm wondering, for all these years, what did Adam call his wife? Eddie? How did Adam address his wife? How did Adam address his wife all these years? How did Adam address? Simple. Honey? Darling? Sweetheart? How did Adam address his wife all these years? God has just finished pronouncing a pun, you know, huge. Everything is lost now. They're about to be thrown out of the garden. Serpent is cursed, woman is punished, Adam is punished, and out of the blue, Adam turns to his wife and says, Eve. I mean, of all the times, why now? I mean, they could have discussed a nice name earlier, right? But why now? You see, I believe one of the reasons is this. They sinned. They were naked. But in that curse to the serpent, God said something. I will put enmity between your seed and her seed. And he shall bruise your head. Adam suddenly, I believe, had a revelation that the only hope is in the seed of the woman. He didn't suddenly say, I am Adam. No. He just named his wife. What did he name his wife? Eve. What does Eve mean? The mother of all living. God said, the moment you eat, you shall die. But Adam received the word of God and he is now calling Eve the mother of all living. When God saw that Adam had received that word about the seed, when God saw that Adam had received the word of the seed, God clothed them with the skin of tunics. Whenever you receive the word about the seed, he will clothe you with the garment of salvation and the robe of righteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your response to the seed will decide whether you are clothed with the garment of salvation and the robe of righteousness. Because God could have clothed them earlier. Adam could have called his wife earlier. It's all happening in sequence. It's all happening for a purpose. Which is why every person born... You see, why didn't he call Adam? Why didn't he suddenly say, I am Adam? Because men are full of themselves most of the time. Yeah, everybody agrees. At least half the audience, congregation agrees. Why didn't Adam say, I am Adam? You remember what the angel told when Mary asked, how can this be since I do not know a man? What did the angel say? The Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore also the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Adam had no role. Holy Spirit and the woman. That's why Adam turns and says, Eve, the mother of all living. And the seed would come out and say, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is so beautiful, you know. From the very woman who was deceived, this is the goodness of God. He said, I will bring out the seed that will give all life. From you and I who were in our sin, God says, I will make you a kingdom of priests and kings. God is in the business of transformation. He doesn't throw, he transforms. And because we were all born after Adam and Eve, again I want to tell you, your future will depend on how you see the seed. Adam's sons, Cain and Abel. Cain rejected the seed. Abel accepted the seed. Jacob and Esau. Esau rejected the seed. Jacob accepted the seed. I have hated Esau and I have loved Jacob. What you do with the seed will tell you how God will respond to you. Hallelujah. I'm nowhere. Hallelujah. You know, it's time we threw our fig leaves of religion and got to where the Lord wants us to be. Born again of water and the Spirit. I want to tell you one thing. People say we have the Holy Spirit. Yes, they have the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit is with them to try and convert them. But the moment you accept Jesus, the Holy Spirit will come into you. And then when the baptism of the Holy Spirit happens, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, with, in, and upon. Every Christian will say, we have the Holy Spirit. Of course, the Holy Spirit is with them. He's not only with them, he's with every Hindu, Muslim, everyone. Trying to convert them. I will give you the word. I don't want to just say. I will give you the word. Galatians chapter 3, verse 2. Paul is asking to the Galatian church, this only I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? How did you receive the Spirit? By the hearing of? Without hearing the word of God, are you telling me you have the Spirit? Paul wants to know. Paul is asking you, this only I want to know. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of the faith? Verse 5. Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of the faith? Hallelujah. The moment you hear about the word and you accept Jesus, the Spirit comes into you. So everyone who receives the word becomes spiritually alive. By the way, in that context, Paul assumes that miracles are commonplace in the church. He who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, commonplace. We should expect it. I speak healing. Right now I speak healing. If any of you have any diseases, I speak healing in Jesus' name. The same God is here. The same Spirit is working. Hallelujah. When you are born again, verses leap out. The Bible comes alive. It's not a dead book. It is alive. The Spirit of God teaches you. So the final question about being born again is this. Second, when should I be born again? Whatever age you are right now, is the time to be born. whatever age you are right now, is the time for you to be born again. 2 Corinthians 6:2, the scripture is so beautiful. It says, behold, now is the accepted time. Now, thank you. You might expect him, the writer, to say, and today is the day. But he doesn't say today is the day. He says, now is the day of salvation. It's always now, 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 now. The moment you accept Jesus, your name will be written in the Lamb's book of life. And the Spirit himself, Romans chapter 8 verse 16, the Spirit himself will bear witness with each one of our spirits that you and I are the children of God.